Thank you, Madam Chair. And indeed, there is a short summary of the report in the back. The full document is available online at the website through the Office of the Internet Monitor. To the extent that you're interested in all of the data that I'll reference and lots of other data that I won't be talking about tonight. Thank you for the invitation to give a short presentation about the report. As many of you know, the OIM has a number of key responsibilities, making recommendations for improving policy, practices, and training in the Denver Police and Denver Sheriff Department, monitoring and making recommendations on internal affairs investigations and disciplinary findings, monitoring officer-involved shooting and in-custody death investigations, conducting outreach to the community and law enforcement, and cultivating officer and community member dialogue through mediation. And the annual report has highlights from each of these areas of our operations in 2016, and I'll just touch on a number of them briefly here tonight. Regarding policy recommendation and revision, as many of you know, the Denver Police Department initiated a pilot project on the use of body-worn cameras in 2014 in the 6th Police District. The OIM initiated a data-driven evaluation of that pilot project, principally focusing on whether the cameras that were deployed during the pilot actually recorded use of force incidents that took place within the 6th District or by officers who were working within that district. We issued a report in March of 2015, making a number of findings and issuing 9 recommendations for how, in our view, the DPD should revise the body-worn camera pilot policy and program before cameras were deployed department-wide, which has now begun, in fact, in 2016. There were a number of the recommendations touched on a number of areas, including privacy issues, training issues, and issues regarding deployment. And one of the recommendations was that the cameras should be deployed to officers working in an off-duty capacity and to sergeants who are periodically involved in use of force that should be recorded. DPD released the draft policy subsequent to that report in September of 2016 that addressed some, but not all, of the OIM recommendations. In the wake of that release, there was significant feedback to the police department from civil rights groups, the Citizen Oversight Board, and city council members, and the DPD subsequently released a revised policy and agreed to provide body-worn cameras to officers working off-duty and sergeants. So it was a positive change. We were pleased that it was made, and we will continue to monitor the use of body-worn cameras now that they are being deployed to the district. Between July 2014 and January 2015, there were 4 incidents involving police officers firing into moving vehicles based on a threat or a perceived threat being posed by other vehicles. In January 2015, the OIM announced the launch of an evaluation of DPD policy, practices, and training regarding shooting into moving vehicles, and the DPD later announced that it would also be conducting a similar review. During the OIM evaluation, we analyzed recent shootings, reviewed best practices and policies of other jurisdictions, and evaluated the training being provided to officers on shooting into moving vehicles, and we subsequently issued a report with our findings regarding those subjects. The DPD issued a revised policy in June 2015, adding a general prohibition against firing into moving vehicles and significantly strengthening the training being provided to officers regarding tactical approaches and taking steps to avoid being in a position where a car could become a potential threat. We've gone out and audited that training, we've sat through it, it's our view that the revised policy is in many ways consistent with best practices and model policy from other jurisdictions, and the training is also effective. Early intervention systems are an extraordinarily important subject within law enforcement and have become garnered a lot of attention from the U.S. Department of Justice in its law enforcement reform work around the United States. They essentially are systems that aggregate data about police officer performance, lots of different variables about officer performance, in order to potentially identify officers who may be developing problematic patterns of behavior so that enhanced supervision can be put in place or other interventions can be applied to try to prevent serious misconduct from developing down the road. In June of 2013, the OIF initiated a review of the early intervention system within the Denver Police Department. We began an analysis of the early intervention database, the criteria being used to flag officers for potential review, and the quality of the reviews conducted and interventions applied, if any, in cases that have gone through the early intervention system. We also reviewed academic research and other early intervention programs. And our preliminary conclusions from doing that work were basically that the system itself is not fundamentally flawed, but the implementation of the system by the police department was problematic in several ways. While this review was ongoing by the OIM, the DPD made a number of revisions to the early intervention system. They updated the criteria, used flag officers for potential review, created enhanced requirements for reviews of officers who were flagged by the system. I think those were two principal changes, and they also reorganized the unit and did other took other steps to make changes to the early intervention system. I think our view at this point is that we're cautiously optimistic about some of those changes, but we'll plan to revisit this issue in the future to evaluate whether the changes and improve the performance of the early intervention system. In our 2014 annual report, we recommended that the police department revise its policy on racial profiling. The existing policy prohibited profiling if race was the sole basis for making a law enforcement decision, and it did not include gender identity. And we recommended updating the policy to be consistent with more recent federal guidelines. And the DPD, in fact, in 2015, did revise the racial profiling policy to add stronger prohibitions against profiling, and is now also prohibited profiling based on gender identity. We also, in the report, highlight two issues where we believe there's room for improvement in current DPD policy and practice framework. And I'll just touch on both of them briefly. The first relates to the use of the NCIC CCI database, and actually more specifically the misuse of those databases. NCIC, CCIC are law enforcement databases. NCIC is available to pretty much every law enforcement agency in the United States. It's available from terminals inside patrol cars, and they contain a variety of criminal justice record types and other sensitive information about the public. This includes, and this is just a very small excerpt of a very large compilation of data, protection orders, some juvenile arrest records, information about suspected gang or terrorism affiliation, among other kinds of records about the public. The databases are used every day by DPD officers to solve crimes, recover stolen property, and engage in other law enforcement actions to keep people safe. The DPD has a policy on misuse of those databases that includes fairly strong warnings to police officers against such misuse. The policy was revised in late 2015 in a way that didn't address the issues that I'm going to talk about now. But the policy more or less, and it actually DPD policy talks about this in a number of different places, but in the principal location, says that all personnel shall be advised that the NCIC system is covered under the Federal Privacy Act of 1974, which contains criminal penalties for violations. The act provides in part that any person who knowingly and willfully requests or obtains any record concerning an individual from an agency under false pretenses shall be guilty. Personnel shall not use CCIC, NCIC system to obtain information, criminal or otherwise, for personal use, gain, benefit, or remuneration. fairly strong warnings. We decided, based on the cases that came before us, to evaluate potential patterns with respect to this use of the databases. So we looked back 10 years to assess the complaints that have been filed and the complaints that have been sustained from this use of GIC, and that you can see here on the chart with the red, over the table with the red being the sustained cases. And as you can see, every year we get about 1 to 4 sustained cases of proven misuse of NCIC within the department. We also evaluated the discipline that had been imposed in those instances, and generally speaking, these have been reprimand offenses where officers have been issued oral or written reprimands. In some cases, that has been escalated to fine time or one case of short suspension due to the prior disciplinary history of the officer. And I think in a very small number of cases, a fine of 1 or 2 days was applied by the department for these violations. In 2015, there were a number of complaints that caused us to have concerns about this issue. And just by way of example, an officer using NCIC and IT and other databases became phone number. Running the license plate of a car parked in front of his friend, seeing the ex-wife's home. An officer was alleged to have misused NCIC, CCIC, and shared confidential information with another person. And in our view, those examples and others caused us to believe that it was an opportunity and a need to reevaluate the disciplinary framework associated with misuse of the database. So we recommended that the penalties for the misuse of NCIC should be strengthened within the discipline matrix and should carry a range from fine days to termination depending on the seriousness of that misuse and the harm that resulted from it. We also recommended that to ensure fair notice to officers, that the DPD and the Director of Safety provide written notice to officers of the reasons for making such disciplinary change. Factors that will be considered in assigning a particular case to a conduct category within the penalty. In the report, we also discussed the use of force policy and what we believe to be a significant ambiguity in the use of force policy that, in our view, should be corrected. Officers may encounter suspects who attempt to swallow potential contraband, particularly in a narcotics context. And current policy and training are almost entirely silent on whether force can be used to remove potential contraband from the mouth of the person being placed under arrest. In our view, there's a gap in policy and training that forces officers to have to make determinations in the field under tense circumstances without sufficient direction from the department about how to handle that situation. And in our view, this creates potential risks officer and community safety. As we researched an issue, we determined that swallowing contraband in some departments is deemed to be primarily a medical issue, that if someone has been found to be swallowing potential contraband, medical attention is immediately summoned and the doctors make the determination of whether to attempt to extract the material or not. Seattle Police Department recently made this policy change under the auspices of the Department of Justice and the United States Federal Judge. So we recommended in the report that the DPD revise its use of force policy to provide specific guidance on what types of force are permitted or prohibited to remove contraband from the mouth of persons being placed under arrest, and further recommended that the revised policy prohibit the use of strikes to force persons being placed under arrest to spit out potential contraband. Another of our important functions is monitoring